Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come into the house of God. We thank you for the blessing that we have to come and to freely worship here and to lift your name up and to experience your wonderful and magnificent presence in the likeness of our brothers and sisters. We don't come into this place to hear from a man or from a woman, from the old or from the young. We don't come to church for tradition or for ritual. Lord, we come to hear from you. And we fully acknowledge that here at The Rock, Jesus Christ is our senior leader of this church. And it's in the name of Jesus we ask your Holy Spirit would be our teacher today, be our counselor, would lead us and guide us and direct us and equip us to be who you've called us to be, Lord, that we might reflect your glory for the world to see how good of a God you are. And we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. We don't ever think of ourselves better than anybody else here at the church, but we think of ourselves as co-laborers, brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. Lord, we thank you that you would bless all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ today. Lord, we thank you for our local churches like Harvest and The Grove and churches like Sandals and Water of Life and Ecclesia. Lord, we thank you for Emmanuel Baptist and Trinity and Oak Valley and New Creation. Lord, we thank you for our Catholic brothers and sisters and all the churches belonging to the various denominations, the Calvary chapels in the area. Lord, bless them as you have blessed us. We are all working to build your kingdom for your glory. We just go about it with different denominational names. But Lord, we thank you that we are all brothers and sisters in Christ. To you be the praise, to you be the glory, to you be the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
amen.
Amen. Well, if you've got your Bibles, go with me again now into the book of Hebrews and the 11th chapter. If you're just joining us, what we typically do here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center on a Sunday morning and Saturday morning is we go line upon line, precept upon precept. We believe that the Bible was written that way. Therefore, we study it that way. It kind of forces us to address topics that sometimes, you know, we'd want to kind of skip over. But we've been going through it. Now we're in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, and it is an exciting portion of scripture. I think that Hebrews, the 11th chapter, is probably one of the most exciting portions of the New Testament scripture we have, just because we call it the Hall of Faith. And we have been in this subject of faith since the beginning of the year. Some great subjects. If you hadn't heard them or you're just joining us, I encourage you to go online at rockchurch.com and check it out. You can listen and watch all the different messages all the way back for a couple of years, but you can listen to the faith series and all that things and all those things. Today we're going to continue where we've been at. We started a series last week with Pastor Dan. The title of the series is Through Troubled Water, talking about the subject and the story of Noah. And the Bible gives us Noah as a great example of faith. And I believe that there's many lessons that we can learn when it comes to what happened in the story of Noah. And last week, Pastor Dan really kicked it off with a lot of insight, a lot of understanding as to the story of Noah. How big was the ark? How many animals could fit in it? How long did it take? You know, how long was he on the water? How long? All of the different things that we talked about in Noah's life, and that his building the ark was literally the act of faith, that Noah was stepping out and acting on his faith. And the lesson for us is to act on our faith and God would preserve us. And so we're going to continue looking at that message of Noah in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. If you've got your device or your Kindle or your iPad or your Bible or whatever it is, let's just go there and let's read it together. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 7, it tells us, by faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness, which is according to faith. So here we see in the book of Hebrews that Noah is listed to us as a father of faith, a patriarch of faith, an example of great faith, and there's much that we can learn from Noah. But one thing I want to say about Noah is that it's the most obvious thing that we can take out of the story of Noah is that Noah endured a great storm. Right? I mean, 40 days, 40 nights, the great flood of the earth. Pastor Dan talked about the scientific evidence and stuff like that. Noah endured a storm. Can I ask you a question? Do you want to endure the storms of your life? Do you want to learn how to get through and get beyond the hard times and the trials that come your way? Because ultimately, as wishful and hopeful as we might be that we would live a peaceable and easy life, every one of us is going to face storms. Now, I'm not talking about thunder and lightning on your rooftop. I'm talking about circumstantial storms of our lives that will come and that will rattle our foundations. But Noah is the pinnacle, the key example of a man who endured, who survived, who persevered, and was preserved through the storms of life. And today I believe that we can take a lesson from Noah and why and how God preserved him so that when storms come our way, when hardships come our way, when trials come our way, we too can endure and persevere and be a great example of faith to the world around us. So as I was reading this, I want to encourage you to a little bit of advice when it comes to reading. When I read my Bible, sometimes I get real missional when I read my Bible. When I say that, I mean, like this morning, I'll use a classic example. I started reading in the book of 1 Timothy. I didn't want to leave halfway through, so I said, I'm going to read 1 Timothy. And then I got to it, and I was like, well, 1 Timothy was really good. I want to read for my devotion 2 Timothy. So I started reading this, and I just started reading through it. And sometimes that happens to us. When we read our Bibles, we say, okay, I want to get to the next one, so we just read. I want to encourage you, when you read, to exercise thought, to exercise your mind. And what I do when I read my Bibles, a lot of times what I do is I ask questions. Why? What was going on here? What's the background to this? Why is it important that this is in there? I mean, if you think about it, the book of John tells us that all that Jesus did and accomplished, the libraries of the earth could not contain it. So therefore, every word that's in the Bible is very carefully and thoughtfully planned out by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So I was asking myself as I was reading through the book of Hebrews and reading here the seventh verse of the chapter 11, why? Why did God see fit to tell Noah about the impending judgment about to befall humanity? We talked about this last week in Genesis, the sixth chapter, where the story of Noah begins. Now, if you remember, you say, I know all about Noah. I saw the movie. Well, okay. The movie had it right that there was water in a boat. Okay, all right. I remember during the movie, when the movie came out, there was a well-known pastor, a globally well-known pastor, and he'd recommended that all Christians go out and see it. And he got a lot of flack for telling Christians to go see the movie. And so my wife and I, we went and saw the movie. And I remember when I got home, I sat down and I got my Bible out and opened up to Genesis chapter 6, and I read all the way through Genesis chapter 9, and I was like, that isn't how it happened. And then I realized that's exactly it. He was telling people to go see the movie. Why? Because it did it for me. It made me go and open my Bible and read it. Hey, if it'll make me read my Bible, it's a good recommendation. So, you know, here's the deal. If you haven't seen the movie Noah, you gotta go see it and then read your Bible afterwards, okay? But anyways, we learned last week that the condition of humanity over the course of a few generations now had grown severely evil, and that man in his heart and in his mind had grown in opposition to God, that his thoughts and his ways were evil. And the Bible tells us in Genesis, the sixth chapter, that God began to regret creating mankind, that he said in his heart, I will destroy man and beast from the face of this earth. So here God is looking at the condition of the humanity on the earth, and he says to himself, I'm going to start over. The question I ask myself is why? Why did God see fit to warn Noah about the impending judgment? I mean, think about it. Think about it for a moment. You're God. Okay, you're not God, but think about it for a moment, all right? He took dirt and breathed into it, and man existed. So here he says, I'm not feeling this whole humanity thing. I'm going to wipe it out. Why not just start over? Why allow the nature, the sin nature of man to continue in if you're already in regret? Why not just wipe it all out? Noah, he'll be with you or whatever it might be and start fresh. But yet for some reason, God saw fit to tell Noah, to rescue Noah, to preserve Noah. And that was the question and that was the answer today for you and I and what we're looking at. And I believe the answer is very clear to us in Genesis, the sixth chapter. So go with me if you've got your Bibles. Now, if you've got a device, a digital device or something like that, a Bible on your phone, I'm going to read it to you out of the New Living Translation, because for once I actually believe that the New Living Translation translates this Hebrew word that we'll talk about a little bit more accurately in the sense that it's used here in Genesis, the sixth chapter. So beginning in verse number 5, the Bible tells us that God, that humanity is evil and in opposition to God. Verse number 6 and 7, it tells us that God finds it in his heart that he regrets that he created humankind, and he wants to wipe out man and beast from the earth with a great flood. Verse number 8 gives us insight as to why God decided to inform Noah. Here it is. Noah found favor with the Lord. Now, if you've got your New King James Version like I do, it'll say that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord, or with the Lord. That word favor, literally in the Hebrew word, literally means in the sense to the feeling of favor. Can I just say it like this? God liked Noah. I want God to like me. Anybody want the favor of God in their lives? So here we see that God says, I'm going to destroy humanity. But then we see that Noah found favor. The Lord literally liked Noah. Now, the Bible tells us that Abraham was accounted as a friend of God. So here we see that God favored Noah. And I believe it goes on and even further and tells us in verse number 9, a little bit more insight. Here it says, this is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a righteous man, the only blameless person living on the earth at the time. Wow. Okay, that means it was pretty bad. I mean, if you remember Abraham and going back and forth with God over Sodom and Gomorrah, and he says, God, if there's all the way down to 10 righteous people, Lord, would you preserve the city? And God says, yes, for 10 I will. But yet imagine here on the face of the earth, Noah is the only man who was righteous or blameless in the eyes of God. God liked Noah, and Noah found favor. Why? Because he walked in close fellowship with God. So here we see that God informed Noah. God gave Noah instructions to save his household and to continue on the lineage of humanity through this one man, as the Bible tells us. So the question for you and I is, how did Noah, or what did Noah do in order to persevere or to ride out, to endure the storms of life? And a couple of simple thoughts here is that Noah found favor in God. Righteousness brings favor. Righteousness, the Bible tells us that Noah was the only righteous man on the earth. Righteousness brings favor. Now, I remember a long time ago when I was in Bible college, we learned it like this. Righteousness simply defined as this: right standing with God. The Bible tells us that Noah walked with God. So here's Noah in righteousness, or right standing with God. Now, God likes Noah. Why? Because of his right standing with God. Righteousness brings favor. I want favor. C.S. Lewis said that we need to be less concerned about what men think of us and more concerned about what God thinks of us. You see, I want to live a life where God looks at me and he says, hey, I like you. I love you. Hey, listen, I love you. I sent my son to die for you, but I also like you. You understand there's a difference? Let me say it like this. I have two kids. I have a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old. Pray for me. Because literally last week, my wife and I decided it's official. No, there's no question about it. My little girl, Emma, she's a darling. You know, they always said all the little things about the girl wrapping her finger around daddy's heart, and she's daddy's little girl, and absolutely. But my little girl, Emma, she officially entered. We said, there's no question about it. She is officially in her terrible twos. I love my little girl. There's nothing that she could do that would make me not love her. But I'll tell you what, when she is on the ground kicking and screaming for 45 minutes at a time, and I can't get through to her, we can't talk to her, we don't know why, we don't know what, she just wants to throw a temper tantrum. Let me tell you something, I don't like her. You see, righteousness, right standing with God, brings favor in the eyes of God. We need to understand that Noah was delivered because God liked Noah. For any argument to come and say that, well, God chose Noah because of his lineage, because of Seth, or because he was, you know, in the lineage of Seth, or because God chose him because of this or because of that. Any arguments to say other than the fact that God chose Noah because of his righteousness is on shallow ground, because the Bible clearly tells us humanity was evil, in opposition to God, but Noah found favor. Why? Because he walked with God. Righteousness brings favor. Which brings us to the next idea as to Noah's being preserved and enduring through the storms of life, is that righteousness brings favor, which brings deliverance. Righteousness brings favor, which brings deliverance. See, it's because God liked Noah that God delivered Noah. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs that riches and worldly riches don't do anything in the day of wrath to save a man. Riches do nothing, no profit in the day of wrath, but righteousness delivers from death. Verse number 5 goes on and he tells us, the righteousness of the blameless will direct his way aright. Noah walked with God and his righteousness, his paths were directed. But the wicked will fall by his own wickedness. And look again in verse number 6. Again, it tells us, the righteousness of the upright will deliver them. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in the book of Ezekiel, God is speaking to Ezekiel and he says, Ezekiel, I want you to go and tell your people, tell my people, that if they walk away from me, if they turn their backs from me as God Almighty, that I will withdraw my hand from them as a people, and they will have no food, they will have no water, they will have no beasts on the earth, no livestock. They will be in a great famine. He goes on so far as to say that even if Noah, Job, and Daniel were in the land, only those three would be delivered because of their righteousness. So you see, righteousness brings us favor, and that favor and righteousness brings deliverance. Noah was delivered because of his favor with God. I remember a couple of years ago, or 2001, I was in Bible college. And we had just moved out to Oklahoma, and we had just moved into a new house. It was about midway through our school year, and it was a new route to school. And it was one of those busy roads. You know, when I say a busy road, like where the speed limit is 50 miles an hour. It was a main artery through the city, and we drove this road all the time during the evening. But it was my first time driving to school on this road. Well, unbeknownst to me, or in my own ignorance, I didn't realize that right next to me was probably one of the largest high schools in all of Tulsa, Oklahoma, and it was a school zone. Well, being a Californian, you know, we always like to kind of press the speed limit just a little bit. You know what I'm talking about. If the speed limit's 65 on the freeway, we like to push it to 85. You know, just press it just a little bit. Well, so there we were driving to school. The first time I'm driving to school in this new route, and sure enough, there's a police officer. Pulls me over. Did you know that you were driving in a school zone? I look over and I see the big, you know, football stadium, because that's how they are in the Midwest. I mean, monstrous football stadiums. What can I say? I didn't realize it, but I was guilty. So he gave me a ticket, and you know, when you go fast, you get a ticket. But when you more than double the speed limit, it's really a bad ticket. And so I didn't even have a price on my ticket. I had a court date. So I was praying, and I came before God and says, God, listen, I understand. I recognize that what I sow, I reap. I realize that there are consequences for my actions here on earth. And even though I did this in ignorance, you know, I'm guilty of speeding. I was going too fast in the school zone. But Lord, I just ask for your favor. I ask for the hand of God on this because I'm a broke college student and I got no money. And so anyways, I show up to my court date. It's downtown Tulsa. It's like downtown Los Angeles. Lots of big sky-rise buildings, and there's four or five different courthouses. And there I am sitting in a courthouse, realizing I'm in the wrong courtroom. So I go back out, and I ask the court clerk, hey, where is the court that I'm supposed to be in? And she looks up, and she says, you're three buildings over and four stories up. So I had to go and walk around and cross the street and park illegally to get to my court. I know. So there I look on the docket of the court thing, and I see my name, Luke Cobre, traffic. Right there it says, like, there's a little thing, a description, warrant issued for arrest. What? So I go to the clerk, and she says, oh, you missed it. The judge called your name, and you didn't show up. I was in the wrong courthouse. What am I going to do? She says, well, go sit in the courtroom. Maybe the judge, sometimes when he feels good about things, sometimes he'll go through the docket one more time just to see if anybody showed up. So sure enough, I make it into the courtroom, and I kid you not, as the moment my little tush hit that hard pew, the judge called my name. So I go up there, and he reads out, okay, the officer caught you at this, and this is the speed. How do you plead to that? And what am I going to argue? I can't. I was guilty. I was going fast. So I said, Your Honor, I'm so sorry. I'm guilty. Okay. Go wait out in the hallway, and the district attorney, he'll come out and talk to you, and you guys can work out a plan or whatever. So I'm sitting there in the hallway of the courtroom, and there the district attorney comes out to me, and he's in his suit and his tie, and he sits down, and he's just shaking his head. I could tell I'm being judged. Here I'm a blonde California boy in the middle of the Midwest, speeding on their highways, kind of like, all right, you wanna drive fast on our road, we'll show you a thing or two. So he starts shaking his head, he's looking over my files, looking up at the paper, and he says, huh, all right, well, son, you're gonna need to hire an attorney. Why? Because I'm gonna put you in jail for 10 days. I'm gonna seek the full extent of the law on this. And you're gonna go to jail for 10 days, so you need to hire an attorney. We'll contact you. We'll give you another court date where we come back and we can start going at this. And it was just like, I can't go to jail. I won't survive jail. And so he kind of like motions as he's packing up his folder and his paper, and he's about to move on, and he kind of like walks or leans the other direction, and then he kind of looks back, and then he opens up his thing and he just shakes his head. And my dad would say it like this, true story. But he shakes his head and he starts looking, and he looks at the paper and he looks at me and he looks down at his paper and he says, you know what? I don't know why I'm doing this. I don't know why I'm doing this. He says, I'm going to let you off. You're going to need to go to traffic school, and you're going to have to pay the court fees for today. And he says, but if you so much as get a jaywalking ticket in my town, I'll throw the book at you. I was just, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. Sure enough, I got a parking ticket because I parked illegally, but... All that to say, I had prayed, I gave it to God. I said, God, I realized that in my ignorance, I broke the law, and I fully accept the consequences that come from my action, but Lord, I was asking for favor. And now people might come and try to say, well, he was just messing with you because you were a California boy. Regardless of what you might say, he told me to my face, I don't know why I'm doing this. But I believe I know why, because the favor of God on my life. I prayed, I gave it to God, I repented from my mistakes. You see, righteousness brings favor, and favor brings deliverance. That's the meat of the message today. The whole sum of what we're talking about today, how do I endure the storms of life, is the righteousness of God will bring favor, and favor will bring deliverance. That's the meat of the message. But today, let's talk a little bit about this subject of righteousness, because it's so easy to misconstrue and skew this word righteousness. Well, I'm a righteous person. He's a self-righteous person. Whatever it might be. What it is righteousness? Simply put, let's just talk about this for a moment because it's so important for us to understand. First and foremost, our righteousness has to be understood as this, and the bit of perspective and alignment in our lives is that our righteousness is based upon position. Our righteousness is a position. Your righteousness does not come because you attend church enough, because you work hard enough, because you do enough good things in your life. We can't work for it. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it. Our righteousness is not based solely upon our works. Now, I'll get to that because it doesn't mean that we're off the hook. But our righteousness, the foundation of our right standing with God, always has to be based upon position before work. Because if we get wrapped up in the works, if we get wrapped up in doing something, if we get wrapped up on thinking a certain way, then we get wrapped up in this thing that we call religion. And religion did very little to change the world around us. But Jesus, on the other hand, has turned this world upside down. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in Corinthians, we'll go ahead and put it up on the overhead, in 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, he says, for he, God, made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we, the sinful people, might become the righteousness of God in Jesus. This is what we call the great exchange. The righteousness of Jesus Christ was laid down in exchange for the sinful nature of humanity. And literally, Jesus took our position and gave us his. So that now when God looks upon us, he does not see sinful humanity. He sees the righteousness of his Son, Jesus Christ. Our righteousness, first and foremost, our right standing with God always has to be based and built upon the foundation that it is a position given to us by Jesus Christ, accepting him as the leader and the Lord of our life. That is where our righteousness comes from. A couple of days ago, I was camping with some friends, and when we got home, my mom was headed out towards Israel on a missions trip, and so we wanted to stop off at my mom's house and just tell her goodbye. And so we went there, and everybody was a little bit dirty. Everybody was a little bit, you know, tired. So when we walked in, we got to mom and dad's house. I walked right in the door. Saw my dad. He was having a business meeting with some friends and some colleagues there, and they were all sitting there and said, hey guys, how's it going? We walked right to the kitchen. When I walked into the kitchen, I was thirsty. I'd been on the road for a while, so I opened up the fridge, hoping to find something that would quench my thirst. After that, mom was in the other room, so I sat down. We sat down on TV or on the couch and watched TV a little bit until mom wanted to come out and talk to us. And then mom came out, and we took our kids into their jacuzzi bathtub because they got one of those bathtubs that has the jets, and my kids just like wig out about the jets. They're like, Dad, you need to get jets. What can we do to put those on our bathtub? I'm like, kid, get out of here. You see, I can walk in, help myself to their food, to their drink, to their television, to their electricity, to their hot water. I can walk into the most intimate place of a person's dwelling, their own bathroom. Amen. Because I have the position. You see, the colleagues, the friends of my dad that were there in that business meeting, they don't have the right, the position to walk in that house and open up the fridge and sit down on the couch and watch the TV and go to their own personal private bathroom and use that for their facilities. But I was born in to this position, to this understanding of righteousness, or to this understanding of position. You see, you and I, we are born again into position of righteousness. That's why the Bible tells us the old has passed away. We are new creations in Jesus Christ, born into a position of righteousness based upon Jesus exchanging our sinful nature for his righteousness, that we might become the righteousness of God. It's foundational. Cannot do it any other way. But that doesn't let us off the hook in saying, well, that because we're righteous because of Jesus, I get to do whatever I want to do in life. Why? Because righteousness is also a pursuit. It's something that with our own lives, throughout the course of our lives, we pursue righteousness. Paul told Timothy in 1st and 2nd, pursue righteousness. Paul tells us in the Bible, all throughout the New Testament, pursue, chase after righteousness. We don't get to sit back and do nothing because Jesus died on the cross. Now, we have the obligation and the right to now pursue the righteousness of God in Christ. As a matter of fact, Jesus in the book of Matthew in the 5th chapter, in his Beatitudes, in his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Have you ever been hungry before? Now, I'm not talking about hungry like, okay, you know, lunch was a couple hours ago, dinner's coming up, I wonder what I'm going to eat, it would be very nice if I could have a night. I'm talking about like you haven't eaten for a long time. My sister calls it this, hangry. Have you ever been hangry where you're so hungry, you're angry? A couple of weeks ago, my wife and I, we had like red meat like every night, and I just felt like such garbage. I told her, this week I'm going to try the vegetarian thing. I have experienced life in its fullness of being hangry, because celery can only give me so much. Jesus is saying that. He says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst, who are starving, who are famished, who are absolutely thirsting for righteousness, because when you are starving, all you can think about is food. And he says, when you hunger and when you thirst for righteousness, you'll find it. Because righteousness is a pursuit, something that we pursue after, we chase after all of our lives to imitate, to become like Jesus Christ. I remember in 2006, Warren Buffett shocked the world. Warren Buffett, the third richest man, according to Forbes, in the world, shocked the world by writing what he called the philanthropy pledge. And he wrote to the world, and he wrote this pledge, and he says that I commit that at the end of my life, upon my death and at the end of my life, that 99% of my total income and wealth will go to philanthropy. Everybody was shocked. Warren, you've got kids. You've got a family. What about inheritance? What about leaving them something? What about giving them and breaking it up in three equal and separate parts and dispersing it out to them so that they can live blessed? And Warren Buffett had a great quote. He says, I believe that the duty of rich people, of very rich people, is to leave their children with enough to do something, but not enough to do nothing. Think about that for a moment. He says, I believe it is the duty of very rich people to leave their children enough to do something, but not enough to do nothing. We have seen television shows dedicated to the heirs and heiresses of great financial kingdoms and how they waste their life away because they've got everything made. And he says, I commit to give everything I have away. Why? Because I have taught my children how to do what I did, how to live like I lived, how to think like I thought. They already have everything they need, and I'm not going to give them their life so that they can throw it away, because that would be a disaster. And it's exactly the same thing when it comes to the grace of God and our righteousness. You see, the grace of God is enough for us to do something with it and not nothing. Righteousness is a pursuit. The grace of God comes upon us that we can do something with it and become like Jesus. An imitator of Christ. Righteousness is a pursuit. Righteousness is a precedent. A precedent. Righteousness is a precedent. What is a precedent? A precedent is a decision or an action that is made for the first time that sets everything else up as an example or a rule. We use precedent oftentimes in the legal world. The very first time a court rules on something that's never so-and-so suing so-and-so for something, and the court's never seen this type of a case, the very first time a judge rules on that case, it's called setting a legal precedent. From that moment forward, whenever that case comes up, the judges and the legal staff will go back to the original decision and base their decision off of that precedent. You see, your righteousness, my righteousness, will become a precedent, an example, a rule. We draw a line in the sand. All of a sudden, I'm not going to drink what I used to drink. I'm not going to smoke what I used to smoke. I'm not going to speak how I used to speak. I'm not going to think how I used to think. I'm not going to talk the way I used to talk. I'm not going to be around the people I used to be around. Why? Because all of a sudden, I have set a precedent, an example or a rule, a pillar of my life. Now, people will look at me and they will begin to say something is different, and they'll either like it or they'll run from it. But it sets a precedent, a rule. You see, the Bible tells us that Noah was a preacher of righteousness. That wherever Noah went, being the only righteous person on the earth, Noah was a preacher of righteousness. Noah set a precedent, and it was because of that precedent that God spared Noah. Why? Because Noah showed that humanity and all of their evil, humanity and all of their opposing ways of God, that humanity could still be loyal and serve and love and be righteous and walk with God. You might be the only righteous person in your family. You might be the only righteous person that you know in the circles that you walk in. But let me tell you something, by drawing a line in the sand, by realizing that your righteousness is a position based on Christ, that it's a pursuit based on your entire life, and it's a precedent, you will set an example for your life and for those around you that as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. It's an example. It's a rule. We get so wrapped up in our failures. We love to lament in our losses. And when we finally come up to a win, I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm not going to smoke that anymore. I'm going to say no the next time somebody asks me. And we forget and we fall and we trip and we stumble and we say, God, I'm just worthless. I'm useless. How can you love me? And then finally we say yes, or we finally stand up and we say, well, good, that's how it should be all the time. We have got to learn as a church, as a people of God, to celebrate our wins. That when you finally say no to that person, hey, don't just tell yourself, well, that's how it should be by God. I need to keep doing that. Celebrate. Get a little jig on. Hey, I did it. Praise the Lord. I won, and I can do it again, and I can do it again, and I can do it again. Because it's an example, and we all want to win. So when we learn to set an example, a precedent, to celebrate when I make the right choice, then we'll do it again, and we'll do it again, and we'll do it again, and we'll do it again. You see, your precedent, your example, will have a great impact on the people around you. Noah, the Bible tells us in Hebrews 11 chapter, the second part of verse number 7, it says that Noah, by building the ark, condemned the world and became an heir of righteousness, which is according to faith. Noah condemned the world by building an ark. Why? Because Noah was a great example of faith. And great examples of faith, Matthew Henry said it like this, great examples of faith will either condemn or convert the sinner. The people around you, the people that you know, your great faith, your precedent, your righteousness will either condemn them because they know they're not doing what they should be doing, or it will convert them because they know that your life is an example and they want to do what you're doing. But don't let that discourage you. Because we have something further than that. We'll talk about that in a moment. But Noah condemned the world. How did Noah condemn the world? Well, Noah condemned the world's security. How many know we like to think that we're secure? Noah condemned the world's security by his godly fear. Noah condemned the world's unbelief. Well, what are you talking about, man? There ain't no water. Rain? Flood? What are you talking about? Noah condemned the world's unbelief by his great faith. Noah condemned the world's rebellion against God by his obedience to God. And Noah stood out. And because Noah stood out, he became an heir of righteousness. Which brings us to our last point of righteousness, is that righteousness is our inheritance. You see, don't be dismayed. Don't be discouraged that the people that you used to talk to don't want to talk to you anymore. The people that you used to associate with don't want anything to do with you anymore because you've gotten weird, they'll tell you. Or because you're no fun anymore. Don't let that weigh you down or deter you. Why? Because the Bible tells us that we died. We're dead to the old man. That when we came into Jesus Christ, we are a new creation. Which means that that person is dead. Those people don't know me because I'm not that person anymore. My inheritance is not the popularity of the world. My inheritance is not the affections of those around me. We live in a world increasingly, as each year goes by, we live in a world where people begin to determine their effectiveness of life based on how many likes they get on a post on social media. Let me tell you something. Your inheritance is not your popularity. Your inheritance is not your financial gains. Your inheritance is not what you can do here on earth. Your inheritance is the righteousness of God in Christ. We get a little bit of it right now, but we will see God with unveiled face, glory to glory, in a time when there is no weeping, in a place where there is no darkness. We will see Jesus Christ in eternity, where our righteousness is conveyed and demonstrated throughout the entire span of time. Why? That is our inheritance. Paul, as he was talking to Timothy, at the end of his life, he says, Timothy, I'm being poured out like an offering. I'm at the end of my life. He says, Timothy, I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I've kept the faith. And he says, now I prepare for the inheritance of the crown of righteousness that is laid up before me by the King of righteousness. Paul realized in his life, our inheritance, what we receive in life, is not what we get here, but what happens when we see Jesus face to face. I remember my dad was telling everybody when he was in this process of the sabbatical and he's starting up this new company, because he says, you know, when I retire, when I step back, I don't want to live on the church. I don't want to be, you know, dad's words is, I don't want to be a burden to the church. We tell him, Dad, there's no way you could ever be a burden to the church. We're all here because of you. It's not possible. But even still, he says, well, I just don't want to do that. I want to leave my children. I want you guys to be rich from me, from dad. I want to leave you an inheritance. And I remember I was talking to dad, and I said, Dad, one time I told him, I said, Dad, you have already left us the greatest inheritance we could ever have. You told me about Jesus. I have the greatest inheritance I could ever have, the righteousness of God in Christ. Your inheritance isn't the acceptance of humanity. It's the righteousness of God. We get a glimpse of it now, but we will see it with unveiled face. And when we have that perspective, when we have the understanding that it was Noah's righteousness because of his favor that brought him deliverance, now when we see the storms of life and they come banging on our door and they come rattling the foundations of our life, we realize that, you know what? My position is in Christ. That my life has been a life of pursuing righteousness after Jesus. I hunger and thirst. My life is a precedent, an example for the world to see. And my inheritance is God's righteousness, which means I can see the circumstance of today, but I know that forward thinking and looking beyond the corner, God has something great and mighty in store for me, and it's my inheritance. When we have that, the storms of life can't shake our lives. They can't rattle us. We will make it through. Why? Because we have a bigger picture mindset. And then when Jesus comes in Matthew, the 7th chapter, verse number 24, and he says, those who hear my sayings and do them, I will liken him unto a wise man who built his house upon the rock. And the rains came, and the winds beat upon that house, and it did not fall because it was founded on the rock. When the storms of life come your way, you can endure because you are founded, you are planted, you are built upon the rock of ages, Jesus Christ, the cornerstone of your faith, the cornerstone of your belief, so that way the world will not shake, because you know that looking beyond the storms of today, God has a plan for tomorrow, and you too can endure life's great storms. Because of this word, righteousness, right standing with God, it's a position that we have been given by accepting Jesus. We are born into it from Jesus Christ. We pursue it with all of our lives because we hunger and thirst for it. We set a precedent in our lives and in our families' lives that this will be a rule and an example. And we realize with perspective that it is our inheritance for forward looking. We can and we will endure the storms of life. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Before we leave today, I don't know everybody in this place. Some of you are first time here. Some of you, I just don't know you. And it would be a travesty, it would be a shame for us to leave and to assume and be under the pretense that everybody in this room is in the right place and the right position with God. When the truth is that there are those of you in this place that you need an alignment check in your life. And the Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time. So I want to ask you, first and foremost, do me a favor. Don't get up, don't leave, don't walk around. Give me a couple more minutes of your attention. I promise I'll let you out in just a couple of minutes. But I want to ask you a question. I want you to answer it honestly and openly. Don't beat around the bush. Don't try to make it better because I'm not asking you to answer it out loud. I want you to answer it within, in your own heart. The question is this. If you were to leave this place today and you were to die, as hard as that may be to think, to wrap your head around, to examine, to come to reality that there's a day, the Bible says that each and every one of us is appointed to die and face judgment. Listen, I'm not trying to scare you. I'm not trying to put fear into your life. But the truth is, we all know that we're all one virus, one accident, one epidemic, one incident away from our eternal destiny. And the question I want to ask you is, if you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Just think about that for a moment. If I died, what happened? How you answer that question or how you come about your answer has a lot to say with your position and your place with God. And today I want to just kind of talk about that for a moment. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you hope. A lot of people say that, I hope I get to heaven. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you want, that you think, that you wish, that you desire, that you've got the most positive outlook on life. I try to be a positive person. Did you know that nowhere in God's Word does it say that that will get you into heaven? You can't hope your way into heaven. You can't desire or wish or think your way into heaven. It doesn't work that way. Take it a little bit further than that. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, listen, that because you attend church, what? I know, I'm here today. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you're here in church, hearing the pastor preach, that you go to church on Christmas and on Easter and you came today. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you growing up that you were a Christian, that you had somebody blow smoke and water over you, you had somebody sprinkle water over you, your godparents made a commitment for you when you weren't old enough to make that commitment. Did you know nowhere in the Bible does it say that that will get you into heaven? You can't find that in the Word of God because it's not there. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you volunteer, you work in the children's ministry or the youth ministry or you sing in the choir, you even have a card in your wallet that says you're a member of a church. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible, nowhere in God's Word does it say that that means that you're going to get to heaven? You know what happens is a lot of times we in America, we like to give ourselves labels. We like to associate ourselves with something. Well, I am this or I'm this part of this type of person, whatever it might be. So what we think is, well, I'm going to give myself the label of Christian. Well, I'm not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything like that. When the census came knocking on my door, I just thought that I meant by default that I was a Christian. Got a cross around my neck. I've always worn one. I even have a tattoo somewhere on my body that is a reference to God. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you call yourself a Christian? Because you've given yourself the label or the title of Christian mean that you're going to get into heaven? You know, that's like me sitting in my garage calling myself a car. You know, at no point because I've labeled myself a car, does that make me a car? Never going to happen. You can't label yourself or title yourself into heaven. So often what happens is we think, well, if I'm a good person, we talked about this today, the subject of righteousness. If I try to stand up for social justice, for a good cause, to help out my fellow human being, I give to charitable organizations, I try to help out my fellow person as much as I can, I try to do more good in my life than I do bad, good people go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that? As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that according to God's righteousness, our good deeds are like filthy rags. Remember we talked about the foundation of our righteousness. It's not based on work. You can't earn it. You can't deserve it. You can't buy it. You can't sit in church long enough to have it. The only thing you and I can do is accept it because ultimately we can't do anything on our own to get to God's heaven. It's God's heaven, God's way. The Bible tells us that we have all, every one of us, have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way, and that's through Jesus. Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through him. You know, as much as we'd like to say, well, you find God your way, I'll find God my way, we'll all get there the same. That's like saying all roads lead to the moon. I'm sorry. It doesn't work that way. The only way we can get to God's heaven is through Jesus Christ, God's way. Jesus says in the book of John, the third chapter, speaking to a religious leader, a man who memorized books of the Bible, the first five books of the Bible he had memorized. A man who gave to the poor, a man who said all the right things, did all the right things, who wore all the right clothes. And Jesus, you would think, would pat this man on the back when he comes and asks about eternal life. But Jesus says, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, you must be born again. What does born again mean? Well, it's not what Hollywood or the internet or society's made it out to be, crazy, weirdo, out of control Christianity. Born again, from the beginning to the end of the Bible, has always, always meant the same thing in the heart and in the eyes of God. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart, you've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, the very last book of the Bible, Jesus is speaking to the church, to you and I. He's speaking to us. And he says, I'm coming back and there'll be a time when I come back. And I'd rather find that you're hot or I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement. And what this is it's Jesus' final plea to the church, to you and I, his people, to say, stop trying to do this on your own, your way, and start doing it God's way. He says, you think that you're rich, you think that you're clothed, but you don't realize how poor and destitute and naked you are. Oh, I wish that you would come to me, Jesus says. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means that you've got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs. You're not wholehearted for God, you're not wholehearted against God. Think of it like this. In any relationship you have on earth, whether it be a friendship, a professional relationship, a great love, your children, if you were to go to that other person, you say, you know what, I want to give you the very minimum effort I can, and I want this relationship to bud and flourish, you know that that relationship wouldn't prosper. But yet we think that we can come and we can give God just a moment of our time, an hour, a month, or a week, a token prayer even once and again, and think that God sent Jesus Christ to die on a cross, and that's all we had to do, when the truth is God says, I want all of your heart, I want all of your life. And today I want to give you that opportunity today. The Bible says that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. And like any gift, you have the free will choice. When you get a birthday present or a Christmas present, you have a choice. Are you going to keep it or are you going to return it? You have a choice, the free will choice, to accept the gift of God or to reject it. God's not a manipulator, a conniver. He won't force his way or make his way in. It's your call. Today I want to give you the opportunity to accept that gift, the gift of salvation. Jesus came and he said, I have come that you might have life and more abundantly. It's so important what happens to us when we die, but it starts now on earth. To stop trying to do life your way, that fill that emptiness with all the different things that you've tried to fill it up with. Why? Because it's a God-sized hole on the inside of your life. Can be filled with Jesus Christ. There you'll find fulfillment. And today is the day of your salvation. Who should raise their hands or who should do this? Here's what we're going to do. We're going to raise our hands in just a moment. I'll count to three. I'll go one, two, and then I count to three. I'll go three. Just like that, I'll smack my hands. You see, Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. But he goes on, he says, but if you deny him, he'll deny you. The decision's yours. You say, Pastor Luke, if I raise my hand, I don't know if I'm gonna be able to do that. I'm going to be embarrassed. Listen, I'm not going to embarrass you. But even if you were embarrassed because you raised your hand in church, can I just share something with you? If you can't go forward for God in a warm and welcome and loving place like the church, what makes you think you'll be able to do that outside in the real world when people don't understand and people don't support? It starts by making a decision. And what you're doing by the raising your hand is you're saying, I want to make a decision. Today, I am making the decision to give God my heart, to give God my life through Jesus Christ. I am making a decision to follow Jesus. I am making a decision to give my heart, my life to Jesus Christ, to fill that emptiness on the inside. You're making a decision. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. I won't embarrass you. Who should raise their hands today? Well, if you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus, if that's you in just a moment, get ready. When I count to three, pop your hand up. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group. You went to a Harvest Crusade and prayed that prayer once before, or even on TV, but you've never really followed through. Listen, if that's you in this place, just a moment, when I count to three, get your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. Who should raise their hands? If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God, saying, listen, I love you enough, I respect you enough to tell you the truth, even if it hurts, that you're not going to make it based on your own devices and your own ways. It's time to stop doing life your way and start doing things God's way. And it starts today by making that decision. Listen, you've had dentist and DMV and doctor's appointments. Today, it's a divine appointment. You're here right now for a reason, because the Spirit of God is calling you. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. Today, the Spirit of God's speaking to you, and if he is, it's time for you to respond. Make that decision. I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it, and then right after that, we'll follow through together, you and I, changing your destiny. But it starts today, from the side to side in this auditorium, from the front row to the back, where you guys all the way in the back, even you guys in the family rooms, I can see you through the windows. If that's you in this place, get ready in just a moment. When I count to three, pop your hand up. Maybe you're outside hearing the sound of my voice, or in the foyer watching on the televisions, or the Love Rock Cafe. Listen, if that's you in just a moment, get ready for you as well. Even if you're at home watching on the television screen or on your iPad or on your mobile device, and you can minimize the browser right now, you can minimize the video, and there's a little blue button you can push right now that says, no God. Somebody will pray with you right there where you're at. The decision is for you today. Don't let it pass you by. The opportunity today, don't let it pass you by. I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you, be proud. You're making the greatest decision you possibly can. Pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. And we'll go forward together from there. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. I got you. Nine back there. 10, I see you right up here. 10 wise people. 11, 12, 13, 14 people right over there, 14. Okay, I got all them now. If I missed you, where's your hands at? 14 people over here, 15, I see you in the back, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Awesome. 22 wise people. Anybody else in this place to say amen? I wonder if I should. Yes. It's the goodness of God calling you in. It's time for you to respond, to come home to Jesus, See, ushers are pointing in that direction. Got you right over there. 22. How many in the family room? Two? Two? All right, what is that, 24? All right, 24 people. Anybody else? Where you at, number 25? Say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. This is your time. This is your moment. Right, everybody's pointing over here. Come on, where you at? Give me a little wave. Ah, got you right over there. Look at you waving. Awesome. Good for you. Number 25. All right, where you at, 26? Let's keep going. Say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on, the Spirit of God's speaking to you. Don't run from God any longer. Time to run to God. It's time for you to accept life. Anybody else? 25 wise people. Hey, I didn't embarrass them. It's time for you to get on it. 25 wise people. Well, hey, let's praise God for 25 wise people. Amen. That's awesome. Okay, here's what we're going to do. For all of those of you that raise your hand, all 25 of you, maybe you're number 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, maybe you're number 95, 91, okay. If you raise your hand, okay, you're making a decision. Now listen, every decision requires action. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You're making a decision by raising your hand. It requires action. And today we're going to do that together. We're going to follow through together, you and me. So if you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, in just a moment I'm going to ask everybody to stand. And if you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you got family, hey, come with me. Or if somebody next to you raised their hand, look at them and say, hey, come on, I'll go with you. And get out of your chair and get into the aisle and come meet me right here at this altar, because we're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So if you're in this place and you raise your hand, let's all stand together. Please, nobody leave as they come forward. But if you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, come on. Get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and come meet me right here. We're going to change destinies together right now. You come. This is your moment. This is your time. You come. This is your moment. This is your time, wherever you're at. Time to come home. Praise God. You guys came. This is so neat. They're still coming. We'll wait for you. But you guys are here. Listen, I see a bunch of parents with small babies. It's amazing, guys. You are setting a precedent. To make a stand. Great job. I want to share with you something fun. Okay, guys, listen. You can wipe that frown upside down. You ever heard somebody say that? Why? Because you're not going to the morgue, all right? You're going to a birthday celebration. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. You're going to get born again today. Good job. Maybe you've never had somebody tell you in your life, but somebody needs to tell you, good job, because you are making the best decision you can possibly make. I mean, that says a lot about you. You are pretty smart. Good job. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy waving at you right over here? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to do a couple of things. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Listen, nothing weird goes on. I promise, okay? I'm as weird as it gets. You made it through me. He's going to take you guys just right over there. He's going to do a couple of things. I'll tell you what they are. First, he's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You would get saved by inviting Jesus to be the Lord and Savior. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? The leader of your life. You're going to invite him into your life. Second thing he's going to do is we don't want you to leave here empty-handed. We want to give you some stuff. So he's going to give you some real easy-to-read literature, some 30 minutes, 20 minutes of just sitting down and reading it just to help point you, because you're going to walk out of this place and say, what do I do next? We're going to set you and point you in the right direction. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want you to get connected with a friend. We'll connect you today with a friend here at church that when you come back to church, they'll meet with you right before church service. They'll buy you a cup of coffee, get you a soda, sit down with you for just a couple of minutes to teach you some things about the Word of God. You're not joining some big, long program. You're just meeting with a friend here at church to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Congratulations. Amen.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.